Hi, good evening. And his recent credits include Girish Karnad's Haya Vadana, which he adapted and directed in Gujarati using elements of popular folk form from the region, and Mirage, a play written by Nisha Abdullah that has run for the past year in many alternative spaces in Bangalore. His first play, Tales of Kutti, won the first runner-up at the Sultan Padamsi Playwriting Awards in 2010, and in 2014, he received the Charles Wallace India Trust Award to study devised theatre and performance making in Lispa. As I said, Chanakya is currently the artistic director of Indian Ensemble, and his new work, Algorithms, looks at the lives of cab drivers working on Uber and Ola. I've had the good fortune of being able to work with Chanakya on this performance, since his interest in the subject and my research work at IIHS have overlapped. Not only did our interests on the subject overlap, but also we both came to the project with an understanding of the kind of role research needs to take in building an evidence base for a performance like this. The Indian Ensemble, as a theatre company, has developed a reputation for having a strong focus on research and rigour, which reflects in the writing of their plays, the form the plays take, the decisions around actors, designers, the way they program their theatre work into particular spaces and festivals. So Chanakya and I have been working on and off over the last 1 year on distilling what the impact of tech companies like Uber and Ola in Bangalore are on the lives of drivers, people who work on them. We've worked together in choosing different kinds of research methods, grappled with questions of how to represent workers' narratives when you start to abstract them and create them into performance or into research, and worked out how larger popular culture, academic, and policy debates need to figure into a performance like this or into a conversation around the subject. The focus of this work, both jointly and independently for us, has been to zero down on the experiences and the life world of the driver, of their interaction with technology and the business models that run this technology. And to say that this life world needs to be accounted for in how we talk about technology and the kind of discussions we have about valorizing it or critiquing it. Also joining us today is Dr. Padmini Ray-Marae, who's sitting up here in the front, who heads the MDes program in digital humanities at the Shishti Institute of Art, Design and Technology. Her research interests and publications encompass comics and game studies, feminism and feminist protest, the history of the book, as well as the role of cultural specificity in the digital world. So the three of us, in very different ways, have been working out how to make the intangible aspects of technology visible and comprehensible. There is something particularly ephemeral and unobservable about the technologies that form the platforms of Uber and Ola, and the technologies that are now being called the fourth industrial revolution. These technologies are set to smarten and automate parts of our everyday life, and they blur the line between the digital and the material, the way we think of machines, the kind of experience we have of machines, what they look like, what they feel like. And these technologies, more than ever, interact with new modes of capitalism to spread far and wide, really solidifying the role of market relations in the experience of a technology. These are also very closely tied to efficiency and a solution-based focus, and we often hear how technology can solve a lot of the world's biggest challenges. Now, in a lot of these large narratives has caused technology to become the base of an urgency to predict what these technologies will do to our futures, our city futures, the future of sociality, the future of governance, the future of truth, information, and data, far and wide-ranging issues. And predictions of what this technology will do are the subject of many high-profile reports from agencies that have a very strong hold in how our cities build infrastructure, how our nations build policy. And this move to predict is also then closely tied to financial industries and financial speculation, and tied to where investments are being made in terms of skilling, education, political investments. So it's a very important time to try and unpack what these moments mean and what this technology means for the lives of the people who are experiencing it every day. And many people are critical of discourses like this, but the criticality and the evidence of that criticality is coming through very narrow domains. A lot of anthropologists, sociologists, political economists are starting to work on these, but of course, a lot of these forms of knowledge are restricted within kind of disciplinary backgrounds and traditions that have to be followed. They come through very complicated modes of writing that are not always accessible to wider publics. And even as technology becomes more and more ubiquitous, the evidence for this criticality seems to be not filtering into popular culture as much as it could be and should be, which is why having a discussion, having an evening around the play algorithms and bringing in Padmini's engagement with comics and games comes at a very timely moment. You know, we want to spend today looking at how different kinds of modes in media can start to articulate these very complex and complicated issues. But before we get into this discussion, I want to ask Chanakya to come up and give us a kind of a dramatized reading from the algorithms, and if you could just set the scene for us as well. And Nohar, please come on stage.
Thank you, Aditi. Thank you all for coming over this evening. It was nice to see the hall filling up slowly. I'll be reading the first scene from the play. And just to give you a bit of a context, the rest of it you will sort of find out as we read the scene. The scene happens in the house of this character called Santosh Kumar, who's originally from Jehanabad, Bihar. And he lives with his wife Sharda and the three children, his two daughters, and the third one is a young boy. And Santosh has just left his job. He used to work like a man Friday at one of the rich sort of real estate kind of tycoon's house, and he's just left the job and he comes home. And this scene is essentially the conversation between Sharda and Santosh that night when he comes back. So yeah, we'll just read it and rest. I hope the scene will do the job. Nohar was a production manager on the production of Algorithms, and she's been through enough rehearsals to now also read the part, because I'm sure the actors had enough of me for 1.5 months, and I couldn't have the guts to call them for one more reading. So I'm sure Nohar will be there, and she'll be reading Sharda, I'll be reading Santosh. Okay, I'll read this. Time 9:30 p.m. Sharda and Santosh almost finishing dinner. Ideally, real food should be used for the scene. Chicken, aloo chokha and rice. Santosh is glued to his phone, watching a video.
आप सच बोल रहे हैं?
ये कोई मजाक करने वाला बात है क्या?
दूसरा नौकरी मिल जाएगा?
मिल गया.
कहाँ?
अरे टैक्सी का.
मतलब? टैक्सी चलाना है अब?
हाँ तो. ऐप पे टैक्सी बुक करने का सिस्टम आया मार्केट में. उसी में लग गए.
काची?
अरे ऐप ये देखो.
इतना अंग्रेजी बुझाता है
तो इसमें अंग्रेजी कौन सा बड़का कठिन है? ई स्टार्ट, ई स्टॉप, ई नेविगेट, ये अपना कमाई, इसमें पूरा स्टार रेटिंग सब इसी में है.
रेड्डी से ज्यादा पैसा दे रहा है ये ऐप?
हाँ तो, और रेड्डी से तो दिखने में भी अच्छा है और बोलता भी कम है, खाली मैसेज आता है.
और गाड़ी किसका है?
वही कंपनी वाला लोग दिया है लोन पे.
कितना लोन लिए हैं?
8 लाख.
8 लाख?
का सुन का हो गई.
8 लाख का उधारी चुकाने का औकात है हमारा?
अरे महीने महीने देना होता है, हर महीने 8,000. ये महीना थोड़ा तकलीफ होगा, लेकिन अगला महीने से सेट हो जाएगा सब.
और अगला महीना का खर्चा?
अरे देख लेंगे. तुम तो ऐसे बोल रहे हो, तुमको भीख मांगने भेजेंगे.
ऐसे नहीं बोल रहे हैं, लेकिन हमको रेड्डी का नौकरी का गरज है, वो छोड़ना मत.
किसी को किसी का गरज नहीं है, समझी? हर आदमी को दूसरा आदमी से कुछ चाहिए. रेड्डी के यहाँ साला इतना साल नौकरी की है, मानते हैं उनको बहुत मदद किया है, बहुत कुछ दिया है. और सबसे पहले बैंगलोर आए थे तो पैसा भी दिया, पर साला हमारा कोई औकात ही नहीं है. वो जैसा बोले वैसा करते रहो, अब ये जी उजुरी नहीं होगा हमसे.
वो सबके साथ होता है, इसमें नौकरी काहे छोड़े?
सबके साथ होता है. पिछला महीना राकेश बीमार था, तुम तीन दिन छुट्टी लिए थे ना, उसका पैसा काट लिया मादरचोद। सलम बान के उसको वहीं मार दे बेटी चोद। उसका घर का गू टट्टी साफ किए, उसका बीवी को हम खुद अस्पताल लेकर गए, उसका घर खाना बनाया, उसका बेटा साला हमको बिहारी बिहारी बुलाता है और गरियाता है। ये सबके साथ होता है। अब दिखाते हैं साले को बिहारी क्या चीज होता है। उसका घर का सामने गाड़ी खड़ा करके थूकेंगे मादर चोद।
बच्चा लोग सो रहा है, गाली मत दो।
बच्चा लोग को सब गाली बताए आजकल।
खुंदक में नौकरी छोड़ के कुछ नहीं मिलेगा।
अरे हमको नहीं करना उसका नौकरी, बहुत हो गया बेइज्जती।
तो टैक्सी चलाने से इज्जत मिलेगा?
हाँ, अपना टाइम का मालिक रहेंगे हम, कोई बाप दादा गुरु चेले वाला हिसाब नहीं है। पैसा अकाउंट में हर हफ्ते मिलता रहेगा।
हाँ तो आराम से भी बता सकते हो, इतना काहे बमक रहे हो?
नहीं तो हर चीज में तुम जांच पड़ताल करती हो।
हम इतना बोल रहे हैं कि उसका नौकरी मत छोड़ो। रेड्डी को हमारा कोई गरज नहीं, लेकिन हमको उसका है, समझे?
तुमको चिट्ठी भेजा था क्या बोल के?
मजाक मत बनाओ अब तुम।
नहीं तुम तो बहुत ज्ञानी हो गए ना, स्कूल में झाड़ू पोछा लगाती हो जो। बोलो बोलो, चुप काहे हो गए?
का बोले?
काहे चुप हो?
अरे का बोले?
यही है कि हम उसका चाटते रहे ना जिंदगी भर।
बच्चों का फीस, दिवाली में बोनस, आपको पैंट शर्ट, मुझे साड़ी पेटीकोट, ये सब दे पाएगा आपका ये ऐप?
सब फटा हुआ पुराना देता है तुमको साला। उस रेड्डी की बीवी का पेटीकोट तुम नहीं पहनोगी अब से, इस बार अपना खरीदेंगे मार्केट से नया।
अरे हमको कोई शर्म नहीं उसकी बीवी का पेटीकोट पहनने में, जो है वो बोल रहे हैं बस।
हाँ तो तुम्हारा पेटीकोट का चक्कर में हम उसका जिंदगी भर चाटते रहे, और खुद का वैल्यू कुछ हो नहीं, हमारा वैल्यू रेड्डी के बल पे टिका है।
ठीक, जो ठीक लगे।
तुम्हारा दुख समेटने में लग जाए। नहीं
नहीं, हम खुश हैं।
हम नहीं है ना,
चार टाइम का खाना, पक्का मकान भाड़े पे, बच्चा लोग का स्कूल, ये सब खुशी नहीं है का?
मन का खुशी भी कुछ होता है ना, ये काम हम मन का खुशी के लिए कर रहे हैं।
अब मन का खुशी का होता है? खुशी तो मन में तो होता है।
अच्छा तो हम बस बाकी दुनिया को खुश करते रहे, अपना कुछ हो नहीं?
अपना ही तो है सब, ये बच्चा घर अपना नहीं है?
अरे अपना बात कर रहे, अपना अकेले का इंडिविजुअल।
तो अभी नौकरी छोड़ के मिल जाएगा खुशी तुमको, अकेले को इंडिविजुअल?
हाँ
ठीक।
ये ठीक ठीक क्या बोल रही है, अंदर से गरिया रही है क्या?
इस बार जो सोचे हैं ना पक्का सोचिएगा।
सब चीज पकने में वक्त लगता है समझी। तुम बैंगलोर आई थी तो था हमारे पास ये सब, आ गया ना समय के साथ।
बता रहे हैं बस।
तुम बता नहीं रहे, आग लगा रहे।
यहाँ का रास्ता सब पता है, टैक्सी कैसे चलाएंगे?
वो सब ऐप में रहता है, वो सबका कोई टेंशन नहीं है।
महीना का खर्चा निकलेगा ना ये ऐप से, कि हम एक और नौकरी खोजने?
तुम खर्चा का चिंता मत करो,
चिंता हम अकेले को है।
हाँ तो बता रहे ना, हो जाएगा। तुम्हारी माँ का तबीयत कैसा है?
ठीक है ही है, भैया बोले कि पटना ले जाएंगे इलाज कराने।
पटना? अरे दिल्ली बोलो ले जाने के लिए।
हमारे भैया से बड़का कंजूस कोई है का?
वो तो है, सौतेला है का? तो साला माँ बीमार है फिर भी इतना कंजूसी?
शायद सौतेला होता तो ले भी जाता।
तुमको नहीं जाना मिलने?
नहीं।
कहे तुमको भी गोद लिए थे क्या?
हाँ अब तो ऐसा ही लगता है, एकदम मन नहीं करता, अजीब सा घिन आता है हमको अपनी माँ से।
अरे इतना गुस्सा रखे कोई फायदा नहीं है, हम अपने बाप से इतना साल बात नहीं किए, लेकिन जिस दिन वो मरा ना बहुत दुख हुआ। बता रहे जाके मिल लो एक बार, इससे पहले कि वो मर जाए।
जाएंगे जब बच्चा लोग का स्कूल में छुट्टी होगा।
अच्छा तब तक तो तुम्हारा माँ का छुट्टी हो गया
तो हमारी तकदीर।
ठीक तुमको सही लगे।
और चावल चढ़ाएं?
नहीं बस।
तो हम जा रहे हैं सोने फिर?
हम जागे रहेंगे।
काहे? पहरेदारी करना है?
अरे नहीं, टैक्सी वाला नौकरी में सुना है रात भर चलाना पड़ता है, आदत डाल रहे हैं। आज रात बैठ के पूरा ऐप समझ लेंगे।
तो आज रात तो सो जाओ, कल नहीं सो पाए तो?
अरे परसों सो लेंगे, तुम जाओ ना सोने।
एक बात बताएं?
बोलो।
एक बार फिर सोच लो रेड्डी का नौकरी के बारे में, चाहिए तो रात को टैक्सी चला लो और दिन में वह नौकरी कर लो।
मतलब 24 घंटा हम बाहर ही रहे नहीं।
अरे बात तो सुनो, अगर टैक्सी का काम में पैसा नहीं मिला तो रेड्डी का नौकरी तो रहेगा, समझ रहे हैं?
हाँ समझ रहे हैं, वो सब हम सोच लिए हैं।
क्या सोचे हैं?
यही कि अब से यही नौकरी करेंगे, अपना खुद का करेंगे, अपना इंडिपेंडेंट एकदम परिंदा टाइप।
कहो तो हम कर ले उसके यहाँ नौकरी।
अरे हम बोल रहे हैं ना, सॉरी
कहो तो हम कर ले उसके यहाँ नौकरी।
कहे द्रौपदी बनने का बहुत शौक है।
अरे हम बोल रहे हैं कहे कि नौकरी नहीं छूटेगा, हम कर लेते हैं।
उसके यहाँ काम कितना होता तुमको पता है?
अरे वो सब हम समझ लेंगे।
समझ तो लेगी पर वहाँ टिकना मुश्किल है, उसका जो मानसिक टॉर्चर है ना, माथा खराब हो जाएगा, वो तुम नहीं सह पाएगी। तुमको कौन बात का डर है रे?
हमको इतना डर है कि पिछला बार आप नौकरी छोड़े थे ना अपना वो चाइनीज खाने का ठेला लगाने के लिए, बस वैसा ना हो जाए।
अच्छा तो तुमको हम पर कॉन्फिडेंस नहीं है। एक महीने का टाइम दो हमको, अगर नहीं हुआ तो उसका पैर पड़ जाएंगे। ठीक है?
ठीक।
तो जाओ सोने, हमको रात पर ये सिस्टम समझना है। Sharda keeps looking at Santosh while he ignores her and is glued to his phone.
To have a kind of run through about maybe our process, because life histories and ethnographies, it's working now, thank you, is something that is very much part of the methodology of my work. But often academic writing can't hold experience, it can't hold affect, and we end up flattening many of the experiences that we're actually trying to portray. And it's something I know writers grapple with all the time, because we're made to write within certain modes. You want to take us through how you use the life history method in your work and how are you able to hold those experiences?
So one of the things was that actually, when if you ask anybody, everybody has an Uber story to share, you know. All of us have had some incident, something that we remember and stuff like that. And so when I actually started thinking about this, one of the things was that, you know, how do I get to know about them more than beyond the questions like, you know, what does it feel like driving in the city? What are the challenges? So that's when I think the idea of the life history approach came in, where I thought that how about we take away the questions around Uber per se, and actually focus a lot on where they came from, what did they do. So the process started by just asking them to map from the time they came to Bangalore. I mean, I just kept that as an anchor, that when they came to the city. And a lot of them didn't start with Uber. So a lot of them started with odd jobs. Somebody was a dhobi. For example, the character on whom the Santosh is based, he at that time had just left the job. And before that, he had a Chinese katela. So it was interesting to see that when he sort of mapped through all of that, it became an interesting sort of kaleidoscope of that person's life. And then one could always go back and say, "Acha 97 mein ye hua tha, acha 2003 mein ye hua tha, 2005 mein ye hua tha." And that helped me tap into their, at least I can say their, the moment they came to Bangalore, and from then onwards, what are the choices that they made, and what choices made them think, and what are the choices they're making now as they're driving Uber or Ola. And at the same time, I met Aditi at a writer's workshop, which was at Shunya, And somebody had shared an article that Aditi wrote in the Hindu on the drivers and the incentive models and the strike that had just happened in Delhi. So that got me intrigued, and I was like, wow, this is like, things are coming together suddenly, like it's in the same workshop. And then we got in touch, and what was very, very, I think what started off for me at least, is that I felt like there was an idea which I had in my mind, and I thought, okay, is this worth pursuing, or am I just the one who's thinking this is happening to them? And then when I just read the article that they had written, and then the other material that she had written, and I felt that, okay, there is a universality that I'm finding now. There is, people are talking about this. And as I went deeper, which is that last year, October, is when I started working on it, exactly 1 year. So, which is when I sort of started finding material that people are talking a lot about future of work. There was a lot of literature around the gig economy, especially in European countries. And so life history was one of the aspects where I think, I feel that helped me get into the personal lives of these people, where just to understand the choices that they make. Of course, it's a fictional scene. It's not a realistic scene, but there are certain choices that when he spoke about what he felt about an old job, what he felt about a new job like this, where he feels he's the king of his time and he owns his time, but that's not the point, because he doesn't come home for two nights. So clearly the time is not in his hand. And that becomes a very interesting entry point into looking at what is it, what is this new kind of way of looking at even a boss. Like there was this boss who would stand on his head and say, tum ghar nahi ja sakte, aaj itna kaam karna hai, itna extra kaam karna hai. But here he could switch it off, but at the same time he can't. So it was a nice, it's a nice tricky space that you are in suddenly. And I think some of Aditi's work helped me do is that it helped me place into a very tangible context, because sometimes life histories can also be like, acha haan, par bahut log ki kahani ho sakti hai aisi. You know, so then when you place it into this context of the strike and the petition which was filed in the High Court, and to just understand the question of work and employment, and then these questions started coming up. And for me, I think that's when a play begins, when you have a personal question and when you have a universal question. And that's the starting point for a play. I don't know if I've answered your question, but broadly, that's what I feel my process has been. And then, of course, writing it, and sort of the interviews that we had, sort of going through them, understanding those interviews. Mayura, who's here, she was a dramaturg on the project. And Mayura and I sat down and actually went through some of the material and said, acha, what are we really trying to talk about? And very often in Indian theatre, we're like, you know, who's a dramaturg? Who's a dramaturg? Everyone is very wary of a dramaturg. But I think a dramaturg is someone who asks the question that I don't want to ask, because I'm very comfortable in my own world, you know. Acha, mera dunya ban gaya hai, maine mujhe play likhna hai. And I know this is the play. But I think a dramaturg becomes an outside objective voice, and the dramaturg says, why are we doing this? For instance, a very simple thing, that a very early conversation that Mayura and I had, that, you know, so it's all going to be a world of men that you are tapping into. So it's better you be aware of that position that you're taking. And I said, yes, that's a very good point. And which is why Sharda's character, if you see in the play, became extremely important. To also talk about what is happening, because we only see them in the car. So what is also happening to the role of women in their lives? A lot of stories are duologues, if you see. The entire play is structured like two characters. And that's a kind of structure I arrived at. But it was very important for someone like Mayura to step in and ask that question and make me think that, and that's where, again, life history became useful, because until then I was listening to his voice and I was trying to decipher what he's trying to say, what sense he's trying to make. And then as we were talking upstairs, that his wife was sitting in the same room when I was interviewing him. There are so many times I wanted to break the interview and ask his wife something, but then the narrative, he just didn't stop. He just kept on talking. And sometimes, you know, as an interviewer, you are like, shall I break the flow? Should I do this? Should I switch off the recorder? what will happen. And then, of course, at some point she left, and then his kids came. And it's so, I mean, I just feel like what life is, just to be in that space and to see in his house also has an imagery effect on you when you're writing the scene. So, yeah.
Padmini, I wanted to ask you, in your work looking at cultural specificities in the digital world, I mean, you know, we see how diverse the narratives of technology are. They're liberating, they're absolutely constraining. How do we start to work out what that means for India or for the global south? Are there particular ways in which digital natives, digital immigrants here experience those?
Yeah, so I think one thing that kind of universalizes this kind of conversation about technology, and as Chanakya was speaking, I was actually thinking of something that I just realized when you were talking about writing the play, is that the way that we are kind of conditioned to think about technology is through the metaphor. Right, so you have the cloud, you have kind of this idea of the frictionless, you have data as the new oil, and these are all ways in which we are encouraged to think about technology to kind of, you know, it's the Kool-Aid that we're kind of, you know, kind of fed to make the neoliberal dream more palatable. And I think, you know, both here and elsewhere, I think the relationship between the metaphor of data, of these technologies, and of the embodied is often incredibly foreign and alien to the way we actually think about technology. So when you speak to somebody about the cloud, they're not thinking about, you know, Google server farms guzzling incredible amounts of electricity in, you know, ruining some landscape somewhere. They're thinking of this organic, fluffy, you know, I just find the fact that they keep using organic kind of, even Twitter, you know, with this little bird, it's an incredibly disingenuous way to kind of represent these things that are incredibly damaging. But what I feel that in India, in a way, I think actually it's exciting, is that because the way that technology is reproduced all over the world is with an understanding of a Western audience who have certain understandings of kind of cultural vocabulary, visual vocabulary, that we often use technologies in unintended ways. So my favorite example of this is the missed call, for example, right? So because Indians kind of thrive in this world of jugaad, which is not an intentional jugaad, but often as a consequence of a misunderstanding or a gap in understanding, that there's often a kind of way out that might not be possible for somebody who is conditioned into the way that these vocabularies kind of transform our lives and the way we think. So I kind of, one idea that I've been playing with recently is this idea that most people who use smartphones, who are semi-literate, are not really aware of the idea of the browser. Like that's actually not a reality to them. The internet, the web, is not something that they're thinking of. When they think of connectivity and the network, they're thinking of apps. And that in itself, the fact that they have a very different vision of what the internet is from much of the rest of the world, I think is interesting and very specific to India.
Chanakya, you it was very interesting to kind of see the visual metaphors that you used in the set design. I think it was very beautifully done, and everyone who's come to see the play has said that. Can you talk us through the kind of decisions you made about that? Because I mean, as you were starting to point out, the kind of metaphors that we use that I have encountered have been, you know, the binaries, the ones and the zeros, and that was also something used in the play, but it fails to kind of hold the complexity of what this technology is, but it also lets people have that accessible metaphor, that it's a very open and public metaphor. So can you talk us through your decisions of how to, you know, give everyone an immersive tech experience through the play?
Yeah, I think this is by far one of my most well-designed plays. So, and the credit really goes to Sridhar Murthy, who did the set design, and Sudarshan Krishna, who did the projection mapping for the play, and Partha Sarthi, who did the lights. So, I mean, the initial conversation around the set design, to be very frank for me, was how do I show a car on stage? Not in the typical way. I don't want to show a steering wheel. I'm done with that. I don't want to show a clutch and accelerator and all that. I don't want to show somebody dragging a chair and saying, "Acha ye gaadi hai, samajh lo." So I was like, you know, how do we show a car? And so when we were discussing that, the first thing that Sridhar told me is that, you know, that's the least of the problem. I said, how are you saying that? That's one of the most common things in the play. He said, how many scenes do you have in the car? I said, I have 4 scenes. He said, it's a play of 13 scenes and you have only 4 scenes. So don't get so caught up with it. Let's talk about the larger metaphors. So people who watched the play and people who didn't, I'll just give you a context. So there are these 3 big flaps on stage, about 10 feet high, which are in the shape of, not exactly in the shape of a phone, but there are these curves at the edge of it. And those flaps essentially became a way to sort of put the metaphor that everybody is sort of consumed in this world. So the phone, though it looks very small in your hand, but on stage you look much smaller than the phone. So hence they had to be that high. And because moment you say that, all theatre makers and producers are like, kitna kharcha hoga, what's the budget? So, and I said, you know, can we not, why do we have to make it 10 feet high? I mean, why do we need something so high? And there were these very interesting debates and disagreements that we had around this thing. And I'm so thankful that he was there in that room, because now when I actually see that in the space, then it really tells you that these people look much smaller in comparison to those 10 feet flaps, which also become surfaces for projection. So that was a set design choice, that's the only set you see. On the floor, we had an algorithmic pattern. So we just used 2 things from the algorithm. One is the decision box, which is actually angled like a triangle, like a diamond, but it's also a square, and within which also some of the scenes happen, especially the home scenes happen there. And then there are these 2 sort of round boxes, which is like the start and the stop in an algorithm. And then there are these strips on which they walk. So every character who walks in the stage has to follow that path and walk. So that's a convention we set, that everybody is following a certain algorithmic sort of path. So there was the floor, and then there was the verticality over there. While we were doing projection design was the most challenging. I really wish Sudarshan was here, but he lives in Chennai. So he left after the show. But while we were working on that, the question of visual metaphors was the most challenging. And I really feel now that, yeah, the ones and zeros is a bit outdated as an idea. And, you know, to be very frank, it was just like we were just like, what do we do? What is the visuality of this scene? Because actually the scene is that there are 2 lawyers who have algorithm as a witness in the court. So they're questioning the algorithm. So there's this interactive thing with the algorithm that they're questioning the algorithm. You just see yes and no. But then I said, visually it's very poor. We need something in the background. And he just put these nice funky ones and zeros going like this, like that, and with colors changing. And I was like, at that moment, I was like, wow, this is great. Let's do it. But you know how means of production sort of make you do things like, you know, yeah, very good, very good. Let's go for it. And then you realize that, okay, that was actually the weakest choice compared to many other images that we see. For instance, we wanted to show the disembodied parts of a driver also. So in one of the scenes where he's driving, we just took a shot of his feet and him constantly working on the clutch and the accelerator. There was one shot of just his hand constantly working with the gear. There's one shot of his eyes, which is he's almost dozing off, and we just sort of mapped it onto a rear view mirror. So I thought those kind of metaphors had a lot of different meaning, where absolutely, you could see a very disembodied sort of identity of a driver also. And it was very important to show that, because then you could see the labor. You could see the physical involvement in this, which you don't see many a times. You think car hai na, matlab, kitna effort padega. But that was the,
And if I can just add to that, I mean, something that we were talking about upstairs is the idea of embodiment, right? And kind of how we tend to forget about the embodied in the digital, and we're encouraged to forget about it, you know, kind of invisibilize the body and it's kind of part of the ether. But I think something that, you know, something like theater does to this kind of research is it kind of inserts the body back. In a way that, you know, it's impossible to do, however many articles you read, to kind of get that kind of the intensity of embodied labor.
And I mean, the ones and zeros might be, you know, an old metaphor, but it's really strong because everyone understands it's a language they don't get.
Yeah.
The moment you say it, it's like, okay, it's a different part, it's a different specialization, it's a different set of knowledge. And that's really one of the biggest issues when you talk about technology in the 4th Industrial Revolution, is that it's coming from such highly, highly specialized fields of knowledge, that how do you even begin to bridge that? You need many disciplines in between to get to that moment. So Padmini, I mean, are there different kinds of media and modes that can get us there? Have there been slightly maybe positive examples where that kind of specialized knowledge is translated, where it can make things more readable? And is there some scope for play there?
Yeah, well, I think, I mean, so I'm just going to give a very quick introduction to my discipline because no one's heard of it. So so I run a master's program in something called digital humanities. And very, very simply put, it explores the intersection of humanities research with computational technology. So how do we use computational technology to expand the questions we ask of humanities research? Because humanities research has been around for hundreds and hundreds of years. But how do we kind of get that to yield newer questions? We can use computational methods to do that. And so one exciting way that I guess, you know, digital humanities does open up knowledge, I think, is that it moves us away from only thinking about the text as the primary vehicle to create meaning. So, you know, we can think of the database, or we can think of the archive, or we can think of the map as way of other ways of conveying knowledge rather than just, you know, just reading and writing. So I think, and you know, I think it's no coincidence that another area that I work on and work with is comics, because I think, you know, comics and or the graphic novel has been incredibly successful at kind of distilling conversations that happen at possibly quite rarefied knowledge, rarefied levels in a way that's very accessible. So Joe Sacco, for example, and his examples of journalism, I mean, incredible pieces of work. And I think the stories that he tells with image and text is a very different story if he had just written those narratives. I think something that, you know, we tend to do in the digital humanities is to think about how to, I guess the technical term is reify these metaphors, to kind of, you know, think through these metaphors as if they were real. So something that I did once, which was a lot of fun, was I actually built a hashtag, which was a box, because a hashtag is a container. And the thing is that we don't kind of follow through the ways in which we think about technology, right? Actually, I mean, if you think about technology, most of it is containers. It's black boxes and containers. And so it kind of helps you kind of get a different perspective on the ways in which we think about technology, which then maybe in turn allows us to demystify it in a way that you don't necessarily have to be incredibly technologically well-informed to, but just to understand how that technology is mediated to us is, you know, part of the way there to kind of understanding it in a more critical manner, I think.
I think one more thing that the play does really well is to play with gender without really mentioning it very strongly or talking about, again, the world of women, which is our kind of quick and correct kind of evaluation of gender issues. But I mean, it's a very kind of obvious fact in India that mobility culture has changed for women, because there is just faith. There's faith in the digital system. There's faith in tracking. There's faith in data points. And while that doesn't fully kind of take the tag away from the driver of being a dangerous masculine figure, it definitely helps, and it does create a particular culture around that. And there are lots of, you know, systems of ratings and evaluations and conversations that get started and stopped because of this kind of very fragile gendered relationship. Can you walk us through how you decided to leave women out and how to use that kind of gendered relationship in the context of the gap?
When you say why to leave women out, in the sense of are you talking the women cab drivers also in that sense? Or are you saying in the narrative of?
In the narrative. It was a world of men that we were looking at.
Yeah. So that's also one of the conversations we had early on, that, you know, one of the questions around gender politics is also the fact that, okay, can we also just look at the masculinity and look at the other relationships with the other genders, right? Very often we get into also boxed into this man-woman conflict only. So one of the scenes in the play, which was the most trickiest scenes, is there are three men in a pool ride, and all three are talking to, one is talking to his girlfriend, one is talking to a woman, and he's abusive with her, and this third guy is a cook, and he's telling his wife back home a recipe for paneer tikka. So as they're having this conversation, one of the things that I wanted to show was how all three of them, without knowing, are constantly playing a dominant role on the women, and how they're controlling them in their own way, and how the car becomes that space where you think, okay, now I'm in the car, so I'm private. Suddenly, as if I've become private, as if the guy in the front can't hear what I'm saying. So there is a moment when he sort of abuses his girlfriend on the phone in the back seat, and the guy in the front, he tells, "Arey nahi, bada shehar, yahan pe log gali dete rehte hain." And he's just, because he doesn't want his wife to know that there is somebody in the cab who's using bad language. Now, when this scene was sort of being written also, and when I was doing it also, there was so much of confusion around what are we trying to say? What are we trying to talk about gender here? And so that was one way I think we sort of looked at it. Okay, can this be also a meaning inside it? And it's strange many a times that that scene was like, everybody sort of found that scene very funny. But within those layers, you also find that there is just a male dominance happening over the phone. The second scene, which is where there's Santosh who's driving a woman to the airport, a woman passenger, and it's late in the night, and they're having a conversation because he's almost dozing off, and she can see that in the rearview mirror, and he hits a sort of speed breaker, and the car sort of wobbles a bit. And she starts talking to him because she wants to keep him awake. And in the conversation, you get to know that she gets to know a lot about him in the conversation. And then he, in the process of the conversation, says, "Aap yahan pe family ke saath rehte hai? Huh? Aap married hai?" And that breaks the complete space. That makes it a very unsafe space. And I wanted that to happen, that yes, it is an unsafe space for a woman, for that suddenly someone asks this. And then there's a moment in the car where he stops the car and says, "Ki madam, ek minute mujhe bathroom jana hai." So he stops the car in the middle of the night and he gets out to pee. Now this was a very important question for me, that she immediately calls up her boyfriend or her husband. I mean, it's a partner. And she calls up and says, "You know, I'm in the middle of the road and this guy has got down to pee. What should I do?" Now, one of the ways is, why do we have to show that women have to be scared? But my point is that, yes, that shows something about our society, that there is fear. I mean, you may not show it, and of course it's a play, so you have to exaggerate it for telling the point that you want to tell. And then you are sort of almost caught in this moral conflict, that should he have gone to pee, considering that a woman might feel unsafe in the middle of the night? And should she have reacted so much? But that's something I want to leave it to the audience. Because I think I don't want to give a moral lecture to anybody. But you can make your own understanding through your own morality of what you think was right. So there is also the moment when she looks back and says, no, of course. But in the moment she says, "I can see him pee." But now that's also a very, very tricky thing, that he's there. And the fact that she knows, okay, fine, what's going to happen? He's there, I can see nothing. He's not thinking of anything wrong. But if I get out of the car, is that more unsafe? Or should I stay in the car? Is that more unsafe? These were some of the questions around how I wanted to also look at, there is masculinity, but then what does it do to the relationship of the women also in the play? Whereas Sharda's story is for me purely the fact that Sharda could not have had this rise in her career, where she suddenly goes from being someone who just sweeps the floor in a local school to getting this high-end job through an online system. Had this system not been there, she could not have come out. And hence there is a status flip that happens in the end of the play, where she tells him, "Hum nahi soenge raat bhar, humko ye phone samajhna hai." So then that's a flip in the narrative which happens, and that hurts him a lot. That hurts his male ego. He's like, how can you get a phone now? And how can you now have this star rating? So I mean, that's how I dealt with it. But yeah. I mean, I'm absolutely open to Any questions that you felt,
even without that last vignette where she has the phone, I kind of felt like the play was really feminist because it allowed for a multitude and a multiplicity of perspectives and voices. So even this kind of, you know, in the pool scene where you have these competing forms of masculinity, that, and even in the scene that you've just described, that it's also about kind of intersectionality as well, right? Because it's also about caste, it's also about class, you know, especially when those three men from very different economic backgrounds are talking to their women in certain ways, that immediately kind of unpacks a way that, again, I don't think is possible to capture just, you know, when you're writing about it.
And I think, you know, between Chanakya's work and kind of the questions I ask in my work, sociologically we're able to kind of work out what these kind of gender impacts are. But there are ways in which the kind of the scripting of these algorithms and the scripting of technology is reinforcing a lot of cultural values that we have and we're trying to fight against. What's the kind of primary gender question we should be asking then for these kind of technologies? Some articulation.
If I knew, I'd be really rich. No, but I think it's less about gender and more about how we think about each other, right? I mean, it's a kind of in terms of, do we see ourselves as part of a community with, say, these drivers or with the buys on Book My Buy? I think, you know, this kind of the whole rating of the individual, this whole kind of idea that you can quantify an individual, even along these vectors of, you know, is chatty or knows directions or whatever. I mean, that in itself is incredibly, I mean, I think it's incredibly degrading, I mean, to kind of, you know, the way we think about individuals. And I think kind of in the designs of these apps, I mean, that's what makes them so insidious, right? That, you know, your worth is determined by this kind of really, you know, fleeting kind of encounter with somebody and is not at all kind of nuanced or well thought out, and is, of course, colored by all these assumptions and conditioning that we come from, you know, due to class, due to caste, all of that. But in terms of gender, I mean, I'm not quite sure. I mean, the only kind of thing that I would say is, as you mentioned, the kind of panic button, the emergency button, I mean, that, of course, has very dangerous kind of implications in terms of surveillance, right? Because it's basically a form of surveillance. And the Internet Democracy Project has done some really interesting work on this, where they're kind of reversing this kind of, you know, conversation about, oh, this is making women more safe, by saying, no, actually all it is doing is it's making women more surveilled. So, you know, how is that working? And ultimately, you know, how useful are these things? It's, you know, it's a shortcut to, you know, to much, much harder things, which is just about educating people about, you know, patriarchy, I guess. So, yeah.
I think in much of the conversations we have around this kind of tech, we also leave out what the role of any kind of state regulation or what the state is or what the government means, because the government is also seen as a primary surveiller also. So now, even in the life world of the play, the state is missing. The court case takes place with the algorithm as the bearer of justice, in a way. I mean, I think it's interesting if we can think about different modes in which does this come up in games and in comics? Does this kind of invisible hand of the government also come in?
So I think it's interesting that I think games allow for multiplicity of endings, and that can then allow for kind of ways in which, you know, kind of choices, paths taken, right? So because it's always a kind of a decision tree that governs a game. So I think in that kind of, if you're looking at an artifact, you know, through the eyes of a game, I think that's one way in which you can think about, you know, how does, say, different levels of authority allow for certain things to happen, and what happens if you manage to kind of break out of that. But one thing to, which is always worth remembering, which I'm always telling my students, is that it is a Truman Show world, because it is designed by the game designer, and you are always going to hit up against the walls of the design of the game. So there are things like sandbox, you know, open world games, which are things like Minecraft, which allow you to kind of be generative, but I'm not sure how you could work in authority or the state in that way. But I think, I mean, there are plenty of games which deal with the idea of state building and regulation. I mean, Civ and Age of Empires, all of these games. But even there, I find that the state, it's more nation rather than state. So there's less about kind of state as regulator. And when it does exist in, say, something like Grand Theft Auto, it is the opposite. So it's the kind of the lawlessness in the eyes of the state.
with any particular reasons you decided to leave that kind of regulatory note out, because that's also a very prevalent discourse when you talk about Uber and Ola and the kinds
of I will just sort of take on what the nation thing which you spoke about. I mean, if you ask me frankly, the petition that was there, from that, one was that, you know, do we want to use the petition as is in the play? And it's always comes handy when you have two lawyers in the team. So both Mayura and Nuhar are lawyers. So it was just important that they said, you know, listen, that's, it's not had a hearing yet. It's not had a decision yet. So by all means, you can't use it in that because you can drive public opinion. So I said, okay, let's see what the argument it's trying to make. And what was very interesting is constantly sort of invokes articles, the right to life. Mm-hmm. And I found that very exciting. I said that, okay, right to life. Now, there's an article written like this in the constitution and the legal systems and all of that. Now, how much of that does make sense to that? And that question can always be asked is what the union is asking and what the case is being fought, are they the same things? Maybe they are not sometimes. Mm-hmm. What they're asking for is maybe not what they want. Maybe it gets carried away in a different way in a courtroom, you know. I felt the arguments that I wanted, I've tried to put it in the play, are more with those larger ideas of the law and the constitution that we are talking about, and to see how there is so much of disconnect, which is why the world of the lawyers is also very stylized in the play and not so realistic, because I wanted that the arguments remain very realistic, but you have the sort of treatment of it so stylized that you feel it's out of this world, as if you don't even know that this article exists, you know. So I feel like sort of my focus went there more to look at that as a larger argument, as opposed to taking on something very specific with respect to the state or let's say a policy change which has happened or some regulatory method that you're talking about. But yeah, that's a choice that came out of it. Yeah. But yeah, I don't know if you have something more to add.
I just kind of think that also kind of practically speaking, kind of rights versus regulation, it's also very regional and state bound as well, right? So, I mean, so as we were discussing earlier, I mean, the New York Union, you know, it's also very, or the London cabbies. I mean, so I think in order to have this kind of universal narrative, the human rights narrative just possibly works better, because otherwise, it, you know, you have to go into the nitty gritty and how do you manage to represent that, I think, in the theatrical space. So, yeah.
And I think the performance did a really good job of even proving how the kind of employment transition that is taking place with Uber and Ola. It isn't the kind of breakdown of employment, the end of the job that it's supposed to be known as in America and Europe. But it takes account for the kind of sticky floor that people have to deal with in the economy, which is they get stuck with low wage, minimum skill jobs. And that life world, I think, comes out very nicely. Would have, you know, in an academic world, it would have taken me reams of paper to try and prove that point against that kind of very Western dominating discourse. So I'm just keeping note of time. I think we started a bit late, but if there are any questions from the audience.
So there is one more story, which is of a character who comes from North Karnataka. So there's one more character in the story. But the choice of one is that one of the people I also met was from Bihar. And the second is the fact that I really found his life story very interesting, where all the kind of odd jobs that he had done. And the fact that how it was very important somehow for me to also put the idea also of the working class that exists in the city. Like a lot of people from Bihar, Assam, Orissa work in Bangalore. And I felt like I had to, it was an interesting story that I had to talk about somebody who lives here. And he also speaks Kannada in the play. And there's a scene where he tells the passenger, "Ki aap Kannada nahi seekhe?" And she says, "Zarurat nahi padi." Now that's so it became important for him to be there, because it's interesting how the upper class never wants to look at the local language as a way to have understand how to survive in the city, but the lower working class always has to learn the local language if they want to survive. So I felt like the choice of having him also made me tap into many other aspects of how we see the city. I don't know if that answers your question, but...
Yeah, one more thing was there, means how did you choose the character portrayal of that particular guy, means in particular drama set, particularly?
How did I choose?
What makes you choose the character, means the character you made? What was your thought process going
on? So, okay, yeah. So, one of the things was that he had constantly kept quitting jobs. And he had this very interesting thing that he kept talking about, ki acha humne 2 mahine kiya wo chhod diya, 4 mahine kiya ye chhod diya, fir hum wahan chale gaye fir hum ye chhod diya, humne wo kiya fir humne chhod diya. And I just felt like it was very important for that character to be there in the story, because it was through that I could also talk that why he was seeking an entry into this app kind of a world, where he felt now I'm not under anyone. So he constantly was under some boss, whatever jobs he did. So placing him in that context was very important. And I think if you ask me the question of Bihar, like this migrant population, a lot of them come from Bihar every day. Whether you look at the metro construction, whether you look at the Gujarat incident that happened recently, I think it's very important to tell the story of people from there. At the same time, there is also a story from North Karnataka. So if you live in Bangalore, a lot of people come from North Karnataka to Bangalore to drive Uber.
I found it very informative. I'm curious about the research part. So, was it a group? You interviewed people. Do you think feedback after the commission of the craft?
Feedback from them?
Yeah.
So,
what's your company?
So yeah, now after I finished the interview, when I actually got in touch with a couple of them, and one of them I said that, you know, maine uska transcript bana liya hai, ab aap sunna chahenge? And he said, nahi, aapne bana liya hai, sab theek hai, aap kariye, aapko jo karna hai. Maine kaha, lekin aapka hai, aapko dekhna hai. Arre nahi, mujhe vishwas hai aap pe, aap kijiye. Then when I called him after I wrote the script, another friend of mine said, you should read it out to him. And I again called him and I said, hum kahan mil sakte hain, aapke ghar aa sakte hain? Nahi, acha main ghar kitne baje pahunchunga mujhe pata nahi hai. So I said, main ab mujhe time bataiye, main aa jata hu. Acha, mere time ka koi bharosa nahi, main agar us taraf aaunga to hum milenge. And then I tried calling him twice again and it never got in touch. I called him for the play, but I knew that it's a peak hour for them to make their living. And when I'm doing these things, I'm also doing from a very, very different privilege. That I'm saying, oh wow, why don't you come to watch your play at Rangashankara? And that's his peak hour to make his living. So, yeah, so I mean, like Raghavendra, who's here, who also helped me with the interviewing, he did a lot of drivers from North Karnataka. Raghavendra himself is from North Karnataka. There were so many times that we tried calling them again, because we wanted to meet them sometimes again. And so many times they wouldn't pick up the phone. So many times it happened that their numbers would change. So many times they would say, "Naan urg bandi dine, naan ivagilla Bangalore lale." Because I'm not in town. I've gone back to my village, and I'll come back and I'll call you. So yes, I'm aware of that. But at the same time, you know, if you ask me frankly, that I had those interviews with me and those things that they shared about their life and work. And for me, it was slowly becoming important to sort of say that through the play, what am I trying to say? And who needs to know this, actually? Because it's very interesting that there was one driver who said, so my initial interviewing process started at the Bangalore International Airport, when there was a P6 parking. There were 300 cars lined up on the open ground. There were no toilets. And Raghu and I went the first time. And it was very interesting that we sat at the back seat of the car. And at every third second, we were holding our breath, because the entire place had the stench of urine. because there's no toilets for them. And half of them would also end up eating their only whatever they had carried with them. Half of them would either buy some tea or something from someone who was selling over there. And it was just sitting there and talking to them. And there was one of the drivers we went to meet. And he just looked at us and I just went to introduce him. My name is Chanakya. I'm trying to understand your life stories and I'm doing this project to make a play. He just did this. Mujhe pata hai mere baare mein. He just did this. And I had to just humbly say, sorry. And I had to leave. And that's when I realized that, you know, one way is that I don't think I can tell them that, listen, now see your stories. Because I'm very sure they know what they're into. So I think it was very important from the consumer point of view, and consumers know some of these stories, but it was just important to put them into a structure, into a narrative, and say that, okay, this is an experience that we have in a cab, but then what does it tell us about the world that we're living in? I really wish if I had met that guy and I had heard the entire scene out, but I couldn't fathom from calling him, asking his time every time because he was feeling uncomfortable. And then he just told me, aap kariye na, mujhe koi problem nahi hai. And I told him that aapka recording mere paas hi rahega, I'm not going to share it. Arre aap share kijiye, mujhe koi farak nahi padta. Now, that also becomes a big ethical question on you, no? That achha yaar, actually, like, I am going to not share this out because it's his job. I mean, because he's openly been critical about his work. So then it becomes a double responsibility on me to make sure that that's not out there in the public domain just for his. But he had no problem with it. But yeah, I mean, I'm just sharing what really happened on the field. Yeah.
Hi, Chanakya. Chanakya, myself, Sunil, I have automated word of mouth marketing. I'm a techno-functional consultant. And very soon we are launching with an application. Now my question is, since it's a technology platform we have been researched about, and when you talked with the Uber driver, did you feel the acceptance of the application? In the play also I could see that he was quite confident. So in the technology platform, there is something called infrastructural problem also. For example, right now, even though how colorful the application looks, there are infrastructural aspect and he's dealing with his livelihood out of it. So can you throw a little bit of your research interpretation? Was he very confident with respect to it, or whether he wasn't never dealt with such kind of situations?
See, the one interesting thing is that the adaptability to smartphone has happened very easily. So now it's no more a thing ke achha ye kuch naya aa gaya hai haath mein. A couple of them who we spoke to, they initially said that initially I took a few days to figure out what this is. But then they, because actually the app is very easy. You just have to do start. So even if you don't know, it says S-T-A-R-T. You might not know that it's actually S-T-A-R-T, but you know it's on the right side of the thing. So you know that's a start trip. And it's interesting that when we were making life histories and I would tell them to make a map on the sheet, even Raghu faced that. They would say, sir, I can't write. So why don't you make the map? I will tell you. And that's when you also realize that actually, we think that, I mean, it's great that he has a phone and he can actually navigate through the road, actually understanding what does it all mean. By the end of it, he needs to know what's his earnings. I felt it was fairly easy for them to navigate through the sort of smartphone app system. What is interesting is when it stops. So there's a line in the play when in the beginning when he says, or app band ho gaya to he says game over. So when it stops is very interesting. So I remember this very initial days when the project was not even there in my mind. I was booked an Uber and there was this young boy who was driving, very young. And he was driving and suddenly his GPS stopped working. He got petrified and he said, sir, map hai kya aapke paas mere ko? I said, हाँ है मेरे पास पर मैं ऐसे मुझे रास्ता पता है आप चलाइए. अच्छा नहीं सर मुझे मैप फॉलो करना पड़ता है लेकिन मैप फॉलो नहीं किया तो क्या होगा. He stopped the car, he switched off the phone, he started the phone again. सर आपको पता है क्या क्या करना है इसमें. I also couldn't figure out because something went wrong with his Google Maps. And then when he started, I said, where are you from? He said, no, sir, I came yesterday from Hassan. So I just came yesterday. I got the registration and using a friend's car, and I pay him weekly and I'll go back home. So I just felt that for him, now if the app stops after me, I don't know kaun aayega mere baad. So the next passenger is someone who does not know the road, and if his map stops, he can't drive. So you see, it's a double-edged sword. So as much as it enables you to come into the city overnight and get onto it and start a life, if it stops, it's a nightmare. Yeah. But it was fairly easy. I didn't feel anybody coming across this problem of, I think it's the first few days and then they get used to it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, I was wondering the questions for both of you. Your story is set in Bangalore, but the app will have different implications, let's say in a city like Mumbai, where there's already an established cab drivers union, there's a community, they support each other, and the acceptance of the app there is much slower. If you see in all the apps, I mean, the taxi driving app is one, the food delivery apps, all of them have very different, because the energy or the community set up in Bombay in all of these trades is very strong. Unlike in Bangalore, where there was no taxi before Uber and Ola came. How does that impact, did you study it? Does the sense of being a part of a union help? Just a thought, yeah.
So absolutely, the way the taxi industry is set up in different cities takes on very different forms. And I think what we've seen with the Mumbai case is that even the role of the union is being put into question because a lot of enough international pressure and national policies that are allowing these companies to have a lot of free rein in how they play the market, let alone the taxi market. And there's a strong role of political parties within that state trying to mediate between these two kind of modes. But the role of the union is really being put into question. These companies are flourishing in Pune and Bombay. So it's a moment to also rethink about how to collectivize and what that form of collective should look like. Like today, October 22nd, was a pan-India band. Now, what kind of effect that's had, we will see. But it's only in 2018 that app drivers across the country have started to realize that there is a similarity in their working conditions. So it could be that there's a different kind of formation that comes up.
Just to add to that, which is why Aditi's involvement was so critical, because I said, but the play can be sort of, it could happen in any city. And Aditi said, no, it is set in Bangalore because the union question is very important. And then I said, actually, you're right. And then we used the Kali Pili taxi in Bombay and the meter issue has never been there in Bombay, right? Like, you know,
autos
you sit
also.
The autos also. Yeah. So then when I also met someone who was part of the union, it's also interesting, who are part of the union, they already have 4 or 5 cars with them. So there's also privilege to be in the union sometimes when you're taking decisions and calling shots, you know. And he said that, you know, I don't drive, but I am fighting for the younger people. And when I meet the younger people, I say, do you associate with the union? He said, nahi sir, kya union? Mereko to koi farak nahi padta hai. Main to idhar se aaya hu, main gaadi chala ke ghar chala jaunga. Yesterday I was in the cab and I asked the guy, do aapko pata hai Delhi mein strike hai? Haan sir, parso maine bhi strike kiya tha. I said, but gaadi to chal raha tha Bangalore mein. He said, haan, hum kuch log milke humne Hebbal mein strike kiya tha. Now we don't know about it. And I said, okay, so apne strike mein kya manga tha? Wohi sir, wo fair ke bare mein, wo fair hamara bahut irregular hai. So I said, acha, to kya hua fir? Koi aaya? Koi nahi aaya. And then he just said, maine chalana shuru kar diya. And then he said, I have been driving for last 2 nights and I have finished 24 trips. I have to finish 12 today and then I'll close it. So, I mean, that's just a moment of reckoning that, you know, it becomes so critical that why her sort of research became so important to understand how are we also viewing cities. Like in Delhi, 1.5 lakh people could go on a strike because there exists an idea of a union before. So then it's not difficult to come into that, and which is why the question of individuality versus a union becomes very interesting in the context of Bangalore. because it's far more individual. I don't care about the union because they don't represent me. I don't associate myself with them. So, yeah, so the difference is there. When it's clearly, it is a different thing.
And just one thing to add to that, I think it's also the fact that the unions don't actually know what they're fighting for, in a sense, because, so I suspect in this failed strike action, something that I've heard often drivers say, although they're not using the language for it, is that they think that the algorithm is gamed, right? That the map, like somebody is gaming the algorithm, and there's something going wrong there, but they're not quite sure what. Now, you know, for people like Aditi and me who study this, even for us, that's quite a difficult thing to explain. So I think, you know, for those questions to be even articulated in a way that it can be addressed properly is a big problem.
So first I will thank you for your novel way of presentation. My question is, why this concept of gender identity becomes so complicated in these days, relevant to the subjects like Call Me Too or Entrance to the Sabarimalai, or the decriminalization of 377, or because it's a very interesting portion. Basically, I'm a psychiatric social worker and belongs to film industry also. But why it is getting so much of complication day to day, and it is mountaining the issues. Day to day, it is opening so many new issues. What is your opinion about that?
So, yes, I think, I mean, it's a consequence of patriarchy being challenged in ways that it hasn't been for centuries, in all kinds of ways, and you know, it's obviously going to reflect in these conversations. In any kind of art that we make, it will be reflected, I think. So.
Yeah, I completely second that. I mean, it's high time we speak about it. I mean, the problem is there's been an absence of it, and hence it's the presence of it is felt like, oh my God, itna kya log baat kar rahe hain? Matlab kyunki nahi tha na. Because it was not there, there's a certain sort of thing coming out now. And I think, again, you have to also sort of look at your own position when you sort of look at any of these things. Again, to try and see, acha, what are you trying to say objectively when you put it in a play, at least in the context of a play, I can say. You know, what am I trying to say when I say something about the gender conflict in my play specifically? I just feel that it's coming out now because it hasn't been said enough, and it's important that we say that. Yeah.
There's a question over there.
Okay. This is more of a story. I was in 2014 in San Francisco, and I had some time between my child going to school and her picking her up in the evening. So one of my friends said, you know, I said, I need a job. I need to do something with my life. So she said, why don't you be an Uber driver? So I said, okay, let me look into this new prospect. And Ubers were sort of coming in. And I love driving, and I was learning the city and all that. So I said, okay, so the way to learn, I wanted to do my own research before I just, without even telling my husband, I started taking Uber cab rides around the city and to see how it would really be, you know, to be a driver. I've never done this in my life. I'm a medical professional, whatever. So I get into the car, I just go. The thing about, I don't know about Uber here as much, but what I noticed is, you know how you always have your ratings, your reviews, and you try to rate that. It was so much work to be a driver, and it was so much work to be the passenger, because you always try to please each other. So it's like a commentary on like the psychological, you're in a small space, and here I am, I'm a chatty person. So for me, as soon as I get in the car, I have to visualize this person and see if he's a chatty person. And I'll be like, hey, how are you? How long have you been doing this? And then some of them will be like, the whole life story, right? And then some of them will be like, yeah. Okay, you know. So you kind of have to gauge how much relationship you want with this person between, you know, whatever, Fifth Avenue and somewhere else. So you have this 20, 30 minutes a person, and you're, and I really did, I went to about 15 different places just to see how it really was to be, and I really took this seriously. And it was just, for me, more than being an Uber driver in the end, I realized I found out I was a great counselor because I've counseled people along the way. I've also been helping with life choices and coaching. You know, I've helped with divorce or marriage, like counseling, really. children, you know, what they should talk, how they should talk about, I have three kids, so how they should talk about their kids in teenage, adolescent health, sexual health, gender issues. I mean, the kinds of conversations and racial and about, you know, politics. So it was quite a learning experience for me about the kind of conversations you can actually have in a small space. I mean, we do this on airlines also, right? When you're your neighbor. Now it's more like, I don't want to talk to my neighbor in the plane. But in this space, you feel like you're gauging, and you know, you get out, and I got so many, whatever, five stars or whatever. I was a wonderful star, a highly rated passenger. Or not, depending on. It's like a game for me also, you know, it was kind of a fun in this thing. I don't know about India, if it's so much of that rating or anything. I don't think we do that. Do we review here or anything? But there is some vulnerability when you're in that small space. You know, there's like a game going on between even the person you're sitting with over there, because and the thing is, it's a transient relationship. You're going to end it as soon as you walk off the, you know, open the door, you're never going to see this person ever again. But here you are, knowing so much about this person's life, and maybe they know about yours. And it was just, to me, it was more like, wow, this is a new type of relationships we're building, you know. And even here, when I've gotten into a couple of times, in India, I don't really do a lot of chatty stuff because I'm not sure how they will take it as much. But I just find it very fascinating. Not as much the technology issue, but just the mind and how we communicate with each other in this small space now. So I decided not to be an Uber driver. In the end, it was too much work. So, but it was fun in the process, the research.
Thank you so much for that. Padmini, are there any other questions, or should we wrap up?
I just want to quickly respond to what you were saying. So something that I think is really interesting is, so it's Uber does allow the customer and both to rate each other. And I think it is really intriguing how all the iconography, if you look at the back end, is completely gamified. It looks like a game. So there's a star and there's, you know, kind of pinks, and like it looks like Candy Crush. And I think there is this kind of way of defanging the gig economy by making it seem almost like a game. And I think that's kind of, in a way, what's kind of dangerous about it. But just one thing that I wanted to kind of say is that what I really enjoy about the kind of methodologies that Chanakya and Aditi used is that it allows for collaborative meaning making, which in the academy has never been encouraged, right? It's always been single author, monograph, you know, you write, you get published, it's all about you. And I think it's to me a much more kind of, well, again, feminist way of working. And it just represents a lot more than we've ever been encouraged to represent. And I think that's a welcome trend, so.
Thank you so much for that, and thank you all for coming, and come back to IIHS for more events. Thank you.